أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. My elders, my brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. We are accustomed to be having or to listening to religious talks, religious lectures by Sheikh Nuru on Thursday nights. Tonight, inshallah, we will do something slightly different, as Brother Hasnain has elaborated. In Islam, acquiring knowledge is very much encouraged. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, Allahumma salli, and the Imams of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam have all encouraged us to spend our time in acquiring knowledge, in furthering our understanding of the environment around us. That's number one. Number two, in Islamic literature, there are some ahadith that have divided knowledge into two groups. Knowledge of the deen, al-ilmul adiyan, and knowledge of the body. So tonight, inshallah, we will discuss and try and get to know more about an important organ, or rather an organ system in the human body, and that is the kidney. In our body, we have two kidneys. These are bean-shaped organs, as you can see on the screen. Can you see my pointer? The red dot? Yes, so these are two organs which are shaped like a bean, which are found towards the back. They lie at the side of the spine. Okay? They are about 10 to 15 centimeters in length. So the size of your kidney is roughly the size of your fist. If you do this, this is the size of your kidney. They weigh about anywhere between 150 to 200 grams, each kidney. And what do you think is the main function of the kidney? Anybody? I'm sure you know. Cleaning of the blood, yes. So that's the main function of the body. So when we look at the kidney, and we study how much blood goes through the kidney, you will be amazed. Every minute, your heart pumps roughly around 5 liters of blood. So 5 liters of blood come out of your heart every minute. 20 to 25% of that blood goes to the kidney. So a major part of that blood is pumped into the kidney. So roughly per minute, 1 to 1.5 liters of blood go through the kidney. And that continues whether you are awake, whether you are sleeping, whether you're eating, whether you're sitting on a Thursday evening at the transition hall listening to me. Your kidney will continue receiving 1 to 1.5 liter of blood every minute. Now, the kidneys receive blood and they produce urine. The urine comes out of the kidney through these two tubes. Can you see these tubes coming out of the kidney? These are called the ureters. They take the urine to this organ here, which is the bladder. Okay? The urinary bladder. When the bladder is empty, it is collapsed. And as it fills with urine, it, you know, have you seen collapsible bottles? We normally take them on a trip. If you want to go to the bathroom, you use a collapsible bottle. As you fill it with water, it starts getting filled up. That's how the bladder works. So the bladder collects urine from both the kidneys, and then there is a small pipe that comes out of the bladder called the urethra, and that takes the urine outside of your body. In males, in gentlemen, just below the bladder here, there is an organ called the prostate. And this urethra passes right in the middle of the prostate gland. Now I'm telling you this because when I talk about diseases of the kidney, I will explain to you the importance or the significance of the prostate gland in gents. Now, the kidney, as you all said, it cleans blood, it filters blood. And therefore, each kidney has got roughly 1 million filter units. This one filter unit is called a nephron. And this basically, I'll simplify it for you. This consists of this round bulb near the artery. This bulb is called the glomerulus. This is the actual filter. So the blood goes into the glomerulus, and this glomerulus filters this blood. It takes away all the excess water and the waste material, and this tube is called the tubule. As the filtered blood comes into this tubule, two processes happen. One, some important stuff is taken back into the body, and some extra waste material is secreted into the tubule. So by the time that the urine reaches this big tube here, this is called the collecting duct, it is already formed. All the waste has been taken off, and all the good stuff that your body needs has been reabsorbed into the bloodstream. Are we together? So all these millions of nephrons filter the blood, and finally you get the end product, which is the urine. Now the kidney does not only filter blood, it has got many other important functions. And I've highlighted here in the slide. So first and foremost, it removes excess water and waste products, as we mentioned. It regulates levels of different types of salt in your body. So there are different salts in your body. Our body contains the common salt, the table salt that we have on the table. It contains sodium. Sodium is very important because it helps in regulating your blood pressure. And it makes you thirsty if it rises. So when we become dehydrated, the level of sodium salt in our body goes up. Our brain says, aha, sodium is going up. I'm thirsty, I need more water. Why? Because we need to dilute the sodium, bring the sodium level down again. So when we drink water, our sodium level will go down and our thirst is gone. That is the precise reason why if you are at sea and you drink sea water, it does not quench your thirst. Because sea water contains a lot of salt. So the more sea water you drink, your sodium level doesn't come down, it remains high and you remain thirsty. But if you drink free water, then your sodium level will come down and your thirst will be quenched. Another important type of salt in your body is called potassium. And this is the most significant salt when it comes to kidney disease. When I get a phone call for a patient with kidney disease, the two most important bits of information I want from the doctor who is referring to me is, number one, what is the level of kidney function? And number two, what is the level of potassium? Because if potassium level goes high, it can stop the heart. About 15, 20 years ago, when they used to do bypass operations of the heart in somebody who has a massive heart attack, they used to stop the heart and then operate on the heart. And they used to inject potassium. You inject potassium and the heart literally stops. Nowadays, because of technological advancement, they actually operate on the heart while it is still beating. They can do it. But in the olden times, no. So that is another type of salt, potassium. And there are many other salts that the kidney regulates. The third important function of the kidney is to regulate acid level in your body. When you eat food and the food is digested, one of the byproducts of that whole process of digestion is production of acid. Your body's pH, acid level, has to be regulated in a very tight frame. If it is too high, your body cannot function, you become very unwell. And if it is too low, you become very unwell. So Allah has created a system that regulates that acid level in your body in that precise window. And that system is the kidney. The kidney is the major part of that acid regulation. The lungs also play a part in regulating acid. If your acid levels go up, you will start breathing more, because the more carbon dioxide you throw out of your body, the less the acid level comes down. So the lungs also play a part. The kidney also produces three types of hormones. The first hormone that is very important, that we kidney doctors work with a lot, is renin. Renin is produced by the kidney when the amount of blood going to the kidney drops. So whatever happens, let's say the blood pressure of the patient falls, okay, or the patient has bled and there is less blood going to the kidney will produce renin, and that leads to a cascade of reactions. A lot of chemicals are produced that results in your blood vessels constricting, and that elevates the blood pressure. Who has heard of the medicine called Ramipril? Ramipril or Losartan? Many people take it, don't they? Lisinopril, Ramipril, Losartan, Candesartan. These are tablets that actually work by stopping the functioning of renin. So renin controls blood pressure. There is another hormone the kidney produces called erythropoietin, or EPO for short. The main function of EPO is to push your bone marrow to produce more red blood cells, to increase your blood count. So the bone marrow is a factory. We all know that the factory has got workers and it needs resource materials, isn't it? I cannot manufacture a plastic bottle if I don't have the plastic beads, which are the resource material to manufacture the plastic bottle. So the main resources that you need to manufacture red blood cells are iron, B12, folate, and protein. When you have that, the bone marrow can start working in producing red blood cells. But sometimes the workers get lazy. So you need a very strict manager. That EPO is the manager. It pushes the bone marrow to produce more red blood cells. And EPO is produced by the kidneys. And then finally, we have vitamin D. So how is vitamin D produced in our body? Can anybody tell me? I'll give you a clue. It increases during summer. Yes. Sun, yes, sunlight. So sunlight causes some reactions in your skin and it produces vitamin D. But there is a problem. That vitamin D is inactive. It needs to be activated. And therefore, the kidney activates vitamin D. I'm smiling because somebody very senior has entered the room. He's a very senior nephrologist and he's my mentor. So I get a bit anxious when I talk about the kidney and he's sat in the audience. So the kidneys actually take that vitamin D that is produced in the skin. You are very right. And the kidneys activate, so the vitamin D is now active. And what is the main function of vitamin D? Aha! I caught you. Okay, who else can tell me what's the main function of vitamin D? Sorry? So vitamin D actually causes absorption, taking up of calcium from your food. When you eat food, your food contains calcium. Vitamin D helps that calcium to enter into the bloodstream. And what is the main function of calcium? Yes? To make your brain strong. Bones strong, yes. So calcium helps in building up bone. And therefore, your bones become stronger. But there is a problem, eh? if after dinner you have chai, chai contains a chemical called tannins that stop calcium from entering the bloodstream, even if you have good amounts of vitamin D. So I have to stop my habit of drinking chai after dinner. So the food takes about 2 to 4 hours to digest. We'll talk later. So that was the normal. So what I explained to you was the normal part. This is how the kidneys function. Okay, so the kidneys don't only filter blood, they have a lot of other functions as well. They help in producing blood cells, they regulate blood pressure, they regulate salts, they regulate the acid level in your body, and they produce vitamin D. Right? Now what happens, now what is kidney failure? So when I, yes. Yes, so kidney failure means that the kidneys cannot work properly, which basically means the kidneys are failing to meet the demand of our body. Okay? And the same thing, the same definition applies to heart failure. Okay, when we say heart failure, it doesn't mean the heart has failed and the person is dead. No, no, no. It means that the heart cannot pump enough blood to meet the demands of the body. There's a problem. So when we say kidney failure, we basically mean that the kidneys, there's a problem with the kidney. It cannot continue to function normally. It is failing to function normally. And there are two types of kidney failure. There is kidney failure that happens suddenly. Okay? So the kidneys are fine. Suddenly, one fine day, bam, something happens and the kidneys are not working. Not one fine day, it can happen over a number of days. But it happens suddenly. It comes across suddenly. And that is called acute kidney injury. That is a term that we use, which is friendly to the patient. So every patient will understand, aha, acute means sudden and kidney injury. So some injury has happened to my kidney suddenly. The other type of kidney disease or kidney failure is called chronic kidney disease. So chronic means something that has happened over a long period of time. It's chronic. Chronic kidney disease is any kidney condition that causes abnormal functioning of the kidney for 3 months or more. That is chronic kidney disease. So we first start with the acute, the sudden kidney failure, the acute kidney injury. The main cause of this sudden acute kidney injury is anything that leads to less blood going to the kidney. Okay, so I'll give you an example. Let's say I have gone for Hajj. Inshallah, may Allah give me tawfiq to go for Hajj. All of us should get tawfiq to go for Hajj. So let's say I've gone for Hajj and I become very dehydrated because now it is peak summer, isn't it? And I don't drink enough water. So what will happen to my blood pressure if I lose water? If I have a plastic pipe and I make multiple holes and the water in the pipe goes out, what happens to the pressure of the water in the pipe? It goes down. Very good. So if the blood pressure goes down, that means there is less blood going to the kidney. That is one example. I'll give you another example. Let's say I want to have some food from a restaurant and I go to a takeaway and I have some nice food and develop diarrhea. I'm losing about 1 liter of fluid every day, but the amount of water that I drink is only 250 mils, which is roughly one glass. What will happen to my blood pressure? Yes? It will go down. This guy will become a doctor, huh? So less blood will go to the kidney. Another example. Somebody was involved in a motor traffic accident and has bled 2 liters of blood. What will happen to the blood pressure? It will go down. Another example, somebody has taken an overdose of his blood pressure tablet. The blood pressure will go down. Right? Somebody has got vomiting. somebody has been burnt and has losing fluid from the skin. So all these causes of kidney failure lead to less blood going to the kidney. The second commonest cause of acute kidney failure is actually problems with the kidney itself, not with the blood going to the kidney. So let's say, for example, somebody has got a kidney infection, a water infection or a urine infection that has become bad, is now affecting the kidneys. The kidneys can fail. Another common condition is developing an allergic reaction within the kidney. Okay? So any medication can give you an allergic reaction within the kidney. The most common types of medication that are known to cause this type of kidney failure are antibiotics. Okay? But any medication. In Africa, I clearly remember one of the commonest causes of kidney failure when I was working in Tanzania was the use of herbal medication. Because in African culture, when somebody became unwell, the first stop shop was the herbal medicine man or the witch doctor. So that would cause allergic reactions in the kidney. So that's another commonest cause. A third commonest cause is anything that causes a swelling or an inflammation in the kidney. Now, I'll explain this to you. Our body has got an immune system, right? The function of the immune system is to do what? Is to fight the infection. Whenever you have anything foreign that enters the body, a bacteria, a virus, any germ that enters into our body will mount an immune reaction to try and fight that bacteria or the virus. Sometimes the body fails to recognize between itself and between a foreign thing. Allah has created our body in such a way that it can recognize that this is my own self. And this is something that's come from outside. Sometimes during a disease condition, that capacity of recognition goes. So in a patient, for example, who has got a problem, an inflammatory condition in the eye, uveitis it's called, the body thinks that the eye is something foreign, it's from outside. And it mounts a defense action against the eye, causing a swelling of the eye. So similarly, it can happen to the kidney as well. There are a number of conditions in which the kidney can become inflamed. And there is no specific cause to it. We don't know what is the cause. It's just something goes wrong and the body... I remember I had one patient who developed a similar sort of acute kidney injury, and she was on dialysis. And she was crying because she was somebody who was very active. She used to work. One fine day she got up. She developed a skin rash, which was part of that reaction the body was having, and everything went downhill from there. It was not her fault. She had done nothing wrong. It's just something, it's one of those things that are beyond your control. The last group of causes are problems which I have termed as plumbing issues. So any blockage, so I had shown you this diagram here. Any cause that would cause a blockage of passing of urine through these tubes. So these are the ureters, I told you. They take the urine from the kidney to the bladder. So if there is any problem in the ureter that causes blockage of the ureter, for example, a stone, a tumor that is blocking the ureter, that will cause this kidney to fail. If I come to the bladder, the commonest causes are bladder stones and bladder tumors. And then we have problems with the prostate in the gents. So all of us gentlemen will have some degree of prostate enlargement after the age of 60 or 55. 1 in 8 people can develop prostate cancer or significant enlargement of the prostate. Now when the prostate gland becomes big, it squeezes the urethra. Remember I said that the prostate gland covers the urethra. The urethra passes right through the prostate gland. So the urethra gets squeezed, so the urine cannot come out of the bladder, and therefore the urine collects in the bladder. Over time, this causes multiple infections, and the urine can go up, backfill, and go up towards the kidney because the whole system is blocked, and the kidneys become enlarged, and that can cause kidney failure. So these are the commonest causes of acute kidney injury. Now we talk about the chronic kidney disease. Chronic kidney disease can be caused by a lot of things. What I've highlighted here are the commonest causes. If I walk into a dialysis center in the US, I can confidently say that almost half of the people who are on dialysis in the US, in any dialysis center, are there because of complications of diabetes. 20 years ago, in Africa, this was not the case. The commonest cause of kidney failure in Africa was malaria, infections, and other conditions. Now, one of the commonest causes of kidney failure in Tanzania, diabetes, high blood pressure. Because now people have moved from the rural areas to the urban areas, their lifestyle has changed, they have chips mayai for lunch, they have mishkaki for dinner, the whole dietary lifestyle pattern has changed. Life has become more urbanized. We have become less active, more inactive. We sit at home, we sit in our car, we sit in our office. And this leads to problems. So diabetes, high blood pressure, these are commonest causes of chronic kidney disease and kidney failure. We have other causes as well, like polycystic kidney disease. This is a condition in which you develop small bags of fluid in the kidney and sometimes in the liver as well. And in the ladies, that can happen in the ovaries. It's called polycystic ovary disease. And there are other causes as well. This is a polycystic kidney. Can you see the difference between the normal kidney and the polycystic kidney? These are the fluid-filled sacs. And they can eat up all the kidney tissue. They expand and cause pressure on the kidney tissue, and that can lead to kidney failure. This is diabetes. This is what diabetes can do to your eye. So the retina, Hasnain, how do you explain retina to a layperson? So I will reiterate what Hasnain said. So the retina is the sensory part of the eye. It's at the back of your eye which captures the light and sends that information to the brain. This is the normal retina. It is very nicely supplied with blood vessels, very nice and orderly. This is what happens in diabetes. Can you see the difference, the damage that the retina undergoes? This is exactly what happens to the kidneys. So chronic kidney disease is divided into 5 stages. Stage 1 and 2 is very early disease, and it's usually managed by your GP. These patients are hardly referred to the kidney doctor in the hospital. Stage 3, again, I would say 50% of these patients are safely managed by the GP. The other 50% come to hospital. But stage 4 and 5, that's called advanced kidney disease. That means your kidneys are working less than 30%. And in this condition now, the patient is referred to the hospital. 10% of the population in the UK suffers from chronic kidney disease. The NHS budget to look after patients with chronic kidney disease in 2009-2010 was £1.64 billion per year. This is how significant this problem is in the UK. So what are the symptoms of kidney failure? So don't look at the screen, look at me first. Commonly, there is no symptom. Majority of the patients, when I'm on call, the majority of the patients come to A&E with a diagnosis of kidney failure because their GP has diagnosed them from a blood test. The patients are well, they are totally fine in themselves. Are we together? So commonly, there is no symptom. But in advanced kidney disease, when the kidney disease is quite advanced, you have features of fluid retention, so the patient will have swelling of their feet, swelling of their eyes, of their face. And in kidney disease, it is very characteristic. The patient will tell you, "Doctor, when I wake up in the morning, my eyes are very puffy. But as the day progresses, the swelling goes away from my eyes and my feet become more swollen because the water gravitates." So swelling of the body. Patients will start developing a metallic taste in the mouth. They feel like they're tasting metal. This is the first sign that waste material is accumulating in your bloodstream. And then obviously as that progresses, the patient starts developing nausea and vomiting. They can have a skin rash or itching. They can feel generally unwell, very non-specific. Sometimes the water retention goes into the lungs, so they may have breathing problems. As the body retains more water, the blood pressure goes up. Remember, the kidney produces EPO to make blood cells. So if the kidney is failing, there is very less EPO, and therefore the blood count drops, which in turn makes the patient more tired. And finally, the patient's bones become very weak because the kidney cannot activate vitamin D. So in these patients, we give them vitamin D tablets. But the more dangerous problem is the high potassium that I spoke about and the water in the lungs. These are the more dangerous problems. These are the tests that we do to diagnose kidney disease. So the commonest test we do is a urine test. Normally, kidneys cannot filter protein. So if I check somebody's urine and it has got blood or protein inside it, then aha, there is a problem. We do some blood tests to look for kidney function. We look at the ultrasound scan of the kidneys. We do a CT scan if we think of any tumors or stones. And finally, if we want to know the exact cause of the kidney disease, we do a biopsy. And I will tell you what that is. This is the ultrasound scan. This is a normal kidney. This is a kidney that is blocked. This black thing you see is urine. Any fluid on an ultrasound scan will look as black. So see this, look at this, this is all black, so that's urine. This is urine accumulating in the kidney because the kidney is blocked. This is the process of doing a kidney biopsy. So the patient lies on his stomach. We inject local anesthesia. We don't put the patient to sleep, okay? And then we use an ultrasound scan. We identify the kidneys and we put a needle into the kidney. And we take 2 to 3 samples of the kidney, very small sample, like a line. And we send it to the lab to see under the microscope. That, in that way, we can know exactly what is the problem with the kidney. So the treatment is very straightforward. For people who are dehydrated or who have lost blood, we give fluid or we replace the blood through the drip. We rehydrate the patient. If it is an infection that has caused kidney failure, we give antibiotics. There are other medications that we give for inflammation. If the kidney system is blocked, we remove or we bypass the blockage. So if a prostate is enlarged, we put a catheter, or we give medication to shrink the prostate, or we remove the prostate through surgery. But in advanced kidney failure, we have 3 options. Either we do dialysis, or we transplant another kidney, or we control the symptoms with medication. For patients who cannot be transplanted or who are not good candidates for dialysis. There are 2 types of dialysis. There is blood dialysis, which is called hemodialysis, in which the blood from the patient goes into the dialysis machine. This machine is the artificial kidney. It filters the blood. And the filtered blood is then returned back to the patient. For hemodialysis, the patient has to come to the hospital 3 times a week, 4 hours each session. That's 12 hours of dialysis per week. The cost of hemodialysis in the UK is more than £30,000 per patient per year. In East Africa, in Tanzania, the cost is roughly £100 per treatment. That means it is £300 per week. How many per month? 1,200 per month? Per year. For as long as this patient is alive. This is a treatment that even the rich cannot afford. I had a patient who came to see me in Bugando Hospital in Mwanza. He was a filthy rich guy. He sold his bungalow, he sold his cars, he sold his assets, and unfortunately he died a poor man. That is kidney disease, unfortunately. So the best method is transplantation. So we take a kidney from a living human being or from somebody who has died recently, and we operate and we insert it here. So the patient's original kidneys remain in the body. The transplanted kidney is inserted near the pelvis, in the lower part of your tummy. And we connect it to the bladder. But remember, this kidney is something foreign. It's coming from outside. So the body will start to fight it. So what we do is we give strong medication to weaken the immune system of the body. So this patient is at a very high risk of getting infection. During the COVID pandemic, we had a lot of stress because of the sheer volume of transplant patients we had. And these patients were actually asked to stay at home, not to come to hospital. We used to call them, we used to send somebody to take the blood tests because their immune system is very weak. So in conclusion, in many cases, kidney disease is preventable. You can prevent kidney disease. So for example, diabetes, blood pressure, these things can be controlled, isn't it? Keep yourself well hydrated, okay? That's very important, particularly in the summer months. If somebody is diabetic or has got high blood pressure, make sure your diabetes and blood pressure are well controlled. Follow your doctor's advice. Avoid strong medications like NSAIDs. So NSAIDs are like Brufen, Nurofen, Brufen, Naproxen, Voltarol, Diclofenac. These are NSAIDs. These strong painkillers cause an allergic reaction to the kidney. So we should try and avoid these strong painkillers. And finally, we should follow our doctor's advice. I will give you 5 minutes to ask questions. So please keep your questions short, to the point. 5 minutes. Yes, Haji Ankar.
Can somebody survive on one kidney?
Yes. So alhamdulillah, Allah has given us two kidneys. When both of them fail, we only transplant one kidney. Because a human being can survive on one kidney. We have patients who donate their kidney to their relatives. They remain with one kidney. The only problem they suffer from is their blood pressure may go slightly high, but very insignificant. They lead perfectly normal lives. So you can lead a perfectly normal life with one kidney. Hassan Uncle?
How do you suggest us as an Asian, our lifestyle? You know, the food-wise, and the way we sleep, the way we do the work, we don't do any exercise, you know. So what, in a nutshell, you can tell us that in our we have got also this, many patients have kidney problems, you know. So what is your best advice for our life living?
So our lifestyle, we will divide it into food and activity, okay? As far as food is concerned, we should have a balanced diet. We should have protein, so we can have meat, or we can have vegetable protein like beans, peas, legumes, dal, that's protein. So we need protein, we need vitamins, so we need to have fruits, we need to have vegetables to give us vitamins. We need some carbohydrates, so some rice is okay, some small amount of bread, is fine. And we need to have a lot of fiber in our diet. So salads, so our plate should be colorful. That's one. More important than that, when you eat food, the food produces energy. We should burn that energy. What we are doing is we are eating food, fine, but we are not burning that energy. We keep it in. So my suggestion is, once you've had your biryani, please go and register with Masumin Sports Club. I'm just joking. I'm just teasing Ali and Shenu there. So we should lead an active lifestyle as much as possible. I'll give you an example. We are going to visit somebody's house or somebody's office. We have two options. There is an elevator and a staircase. By default, we would go to the elevator, isn't it? Try taking the stairs. You want to go from your house to the mosque. Maybe once a week, try walking to the mosque and walk back. In the evening, spend 1 hour which is dedicated for your body. 1 hour out of 24 hours. You can't do 1 hour, 30 minutes. Try and keep yourself active. So if you can't go to the gym and you can't play sports, then at least walk. There was a research study in which they compared two populations, two groups of people. The first group was those who were sitting for most of their day. And the second group was people who stood, who were standing. And they found out that those who were standing had a lifespan longer by about 10 years compared to those who were sitting all the time. So try and keep yourself active. Play some sort of a sport. Do some sort of physical activity. And I'm sure things will be much more different. So eat healthy and try and be physically active. So that is my advice. Yes, Uncle, you wanted to ask a question.
Yeah, thank you, Doctor. What I want to ask you, how long is the waiting list for a kidney transplant? I mean, what chances are there for getting a kidney transplant?
The waiting list is not very straightforward in the UK.
Really?
The waiting list is graded, okay? Now, there are two types of transplant. There is living donor transplant and cadaveric transplant. I will explain to you. Living donor transplant, I'll give you an example. God forbid I get kidney failure, okay? One of my immediate relatives, let's say my brother or my wife, somebody comes forward and says that I will donate my kidney to you. And the kidney is a match, because we do tests to make sure that the kidney tissue matches with my body's tissue. In that case, there is no wait list. Because once the donor and the recipient are ready, immediately we make a referral. So in West Midlands, we have two transplant centers. The first is the QE hospital. So I work in Wolverhampton. We refer most of our patients to QE and some of our patients to Oxford. The next transplant center is where Dr. Rizwan Hamir works, Coventry. So we can refer, and immediately for the living donor transplant, it happens straight away. Cadaveric transplant is when you take a kidney from somebody who has recently passed away. That has got a waiting list. But if a patient is younger, or a patient has been on dialysis for a longer period of time, then they are prioritized to get a transplant. The average wait period is between 2 to 4 years. 2 to 4 years. But I remember I had once made a referral for one of my patients. I look after the Walsall dialysis unit. And I made a referral, and the following week the patient was called for a kidney. And the patient went to QE and said, sorry, I don't like this kidney. This patient who died was 60. I'm looking for somebody who is less than 60. So they said, fine. He went back home and got another call in the afternoon. He was that lucky. So the average wait is 2 to 4 years.
Thank you.
Yes, Asan.
My daughter is in a CT scan, you know. So one of our brother who has recently done this transplant, and you know, I asked my daughter that, will it work will he be abnormal? He said most of the cases are normal, but the rejection is high. So I want to know the rejection, about the rejection.
So the kidney rejection rates right now are actually very low because of the medication that we have. There used to be a time where 50% of the kidneys would get rejected in the early 80s in the UK. I don't know the exact rejection rates now. I have worked in the NHS. I came to the UK in 2016. So I'm working in kidney medicine since 2016 in the UK. Of the transplant patients that I have looked after, about 6 or 7 have rejected only in all these years. Of the 6 or 7 who rejected, half of them did not stop taking their medication. One patient came to me, I remember, his transplant kidney was fried, totally finished. I asked him, Baba, what happened? He says, 6 months ago, my wife told me I'm not going to give you good food anymore at home. So I said, fine, I won't take my medication. So husband, wife, quarreling, and this guy decided to stop taking his medication. These are the reasons we get for people not taking their medication. I'm sure Dr. Walji is very experienced, he's my senior. He must have had a lot of patients who do stop taking medication for trivial reasons. But the commonest cause of rejection is patients who don't take their medication. And right now we have become more stringent. So I will not activate somebody on the transplant list if I know that this person does not take his medication, does not attend clinics, does not adhere to his dialysis prescription. I will not activate him on the transplant list. Because if I give him a kidney and he stops taking his medication, then that is a wasted NHS resource.